In breaking news this afternoon, a man has been charged over the fatal hit run of a Tamarama resident over the weekend. 28-year-old New Zealand lawyer Mitch East was found with critical injuries on Sunday morning. It's thought he had just exited an Uber after a night out when he was hit. Just after 11 o'clock this morning, a 63-year-old man from Bexley was arrested at Granville Police Station. He faces a number of charges, including failing to stop and assist, dangerous driving occasioning death, and using a mobile phone while driving. He's been remanded in custody and will appear in Parramatta Court tomorrow. Keli Lane, the woman convicted of killing her own baby in 1996, has been denied parole today after more than a decade behind bars. As Annie Puller explains, it's the latest test of the state's no body, no parole laws.
Good afternoon. Keli Lane's first bid for freedom has been knocked back under New South Wales' no body, no parole laws. In a statement, the New South Wales Parole Authority said it's not satisfied that the offender has cooperated satisfactorily in police investigations or other actions to identify the location of Tegan. The former champion water polo player gave birth to Tegan in Sydney's Auburn Hospital in 1996. She was discharged with her daughter 2 days later. Lane has always maintained her innocence, insisting she gave the child to her father, a man who she told police was named Andrew Norris or Morris, but despite extensive police investigations, no such person has ever come forward. Police believe that name was given as a false lead in Lane's long trail of lies over the years. In 2010, Lane was found guilty of murdering her daughter Tegan and sentenced to a minimum of 13 years and 5 months in jail.
Did you kill the child?
No, I did not! I did not do anything like that.
Tegan's body has never been found. The parole authority today heard submissions from Lane's legal representatives in a private hearing where they said the 49-year-old was not in a position to provide assistance to police in locating Tegan's remains.
The rules are very strict. The wording is actually that if somebody hasn't cooperated with the police and disclosed the location of the victim's remains or body, they cannot get parole.
Lane will be eligible for parole again in 12 months' time, but legal experts have told 7 News it's likely the 49-year-old will end up serving her 18-year prison sentence in full.
Sydney rail commuters were shocked this morning when they spotted what appeared to be a pistol abandoned on a train seat. They quickly contacted rail staff, who arranged for police to meet the train at Redfern Station. This afternoon, police confirmed it was a gel blaster and are trying to contact its owner. Community leaders in Western Sydney are joining into the immigration debate, saying authorities should slam the brakes on migrant numbers, with suburbs bursting at the seams. Mayors and MPs are saying it's becoming impossible to see a doctor, with roads clogging up as well. Chris Maher has more.
Well, mayors here in Sydney's West say the area is being placed under massive pressure by the current high immigration numbers. Now, a region already well known for its multicultural communities, the mayors here say Sydney's West is bearing the brunt of immigration. In 12 months, there was a record 548,000 new arrivals nationally. Now, in Liverpool, Mayor Ned Manoon says the area is already straining to provide housing and infrastructure like roads, along with health services.
We don't have the train lines, we don't have the schools, and we don't actually have a formula to actually fund this growth. At the moment, people are travelling 3 hours to and from work every day. That number will get worse and worse.
The federal government's immigration policies have come under pressure this week, but there are some in politics who say more immigrants is a good thing for the economy. But in a housing crisis, 44,000 new homes were built in New South Wales. At the same time, the state's immigration reached 186,000. The federal government says a large slice of new arrivals right now is made up of overseas students, and from tomorrow, new policies come into effect to try and wind that back, including tougher financial checks.
69 Rohingya refugees have been rescued off the coast of Indonesia. Dozens more are feared dead after their boat capsized. There are unconfirmed reports the vessel was heading to Australia. Political reporter Isabel Mullen explains.
Well, the refugees reportedly told local fishermen they'd like to come to Australia. Some footage shot by the fishermen shows a large group standing on the hull of an upturned boat. There are conflicting reports over how many people may have lost their lives. More than 50 people has been suggested, despite local authorities claiming everyone was rescued. 42 men, 18 women and 9 children were saved and have been taken back to shore. The wooden boat they'd been travelling in capsized off Indonesia's Aceh province. It is believed to have hit rough seas on Wednesday morning. The group of Rohingya refugees had been travelling from Myanmar. They are a Muslim minority and largely persecuted in their country. If it is confirmed they were on their way to Australia, this will likely reignite the refugee debate in Canberra.
Operation Sovereign Borders is in place, and it is unclear, of course. I wasn't on the boat, nor were you.
So we know that Operation Sovereign Borders has suffered from cuts and being publicly trashed by this government, and it's no wonder that people smugglers are again attempting to make this journey.
It comes around a month after two boats carrying asylum seekers made it to shore in WA. Both groups were sent to Nauru.
There were arrivals in the Kimberley. We dealt with that very swiftly. Those people aren't in Australia.
The Albanese government has insisted people who arrive here illegally will continue to be sent to offshore processing centres.
Accused killer Bolamar Condon has been officially removed from the ranks of the New South Wales police force. He was serving as a constable at the time. He's accused of using his police firearm to kill Luke Davies and Jesse Baird at a Paddington home last month. The 28-year-old remains in custody and is yet to enter a plea to murder charges. He'll return to court next month. Erin Patterson, the woman at the centre of Victoria's deadly mushroom lunch, is now being held in a protected wing in prison. Safety concerns are said to have prompted the move, as Cassie Zervos explains.
So far, Erin Patterson has spent 4 months behind bars, but the accused triple murderer has now been moved to a maximum protection facility as fears grow for her safety. The 49-year-old remains in custody at the Dame Phyllis Frost Centre alongside some of the worst female offenders, including paedophile rapist Mel Khalifa. Ms Patterson was charged with 3 counts of murder and 5 counts of attempted murder, 3 relating to earlier attempts to kill her ex-husband, Simon Patterson.
What took place at the meal? Erin?
Inside the protection unit, Patterson is free to walk around by herself and even has access to a kitchen.
Erin luckily is in a unit where she can cook for herself, which is interesting because they say that she can get any of the materials that you need for cooking. You can get steak, you can get vegetables, you can have salad, and quite possibly mushrooms.
Her victims could have been classed as vulnerable and people may have taken particular offence at those types of alleged crimes, so I can see why they would need to protect her.
A brief of evidence will be served on Monday. It will include documents like medical reports, CCTV from the tip and witness statements, including sole survivor Ian Wilkinson.
3 men have been arrested after a truck full of cannabis was pulled over by police in Sydney's Inner West. Police tracked a rental truck and car from a home in Enfield before stopping it yesterday afternoon. Officers say there were 120 cannabis plants inside the truck with a potential street value of $180,000. Police also raided the Enfield home, seizing more plants and dried cannabis. Well, it's day one of Sydney's Royal Easter Show and it's set to be an action-packed 12 days ahead. Amy Clements joins us live from Olympic Park this afternoon. Hello to you, Amy. There's some pretty good deals on offer at the show this year.
Good afternoon, Sal. Yes, and as always, the Showbag Pavilion is one of the most popular places at the show, and for good reason. This year, there are more than 400 bags to choose from, a new record. And good news for parents too, 89 of those bags are $10 and under.
You don't have to spend much to get a good value in a bag.
My mum literally only sent me here so that I could buy her show bags.
My tip always is to come late in the day to the show bag pavilion, otherwise you've got to cart them about the whole day at the show.
Since gates officially opened here at Sydney Olympic Park this morning, thousands have been pouring in and it's been an action-packed day. At the carnival, plenty of laughter and a few screams too as families make their way around and try all those different rides. Sydney's Royal Rat has also just been crowned. Yes, Sal, you heard that right. Of course, you never know what you're going to get at the show, Sal, and that is half the fun.
There's an award for everyone and everything. All right, thanks for that, Amy. Good luck there.